Welcome back to Shop Talk. I'm Riet Anwat-Cotrillo, and we're talking about Women to Women Connect. That's a conference happening on November 8th at the Philippine Trade and Training Center. And with us now is Maria Mercedes, or Mercy Corrales, Independent Director at Frasser and Neave Limited in Singapore. Mercy will be talking about leadership and how to soar with your influence at the Women to Women Connect conference. Hello, Mercy. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Okay, as Chiki was saying earlier, you have this incredible resume, and so few people in the Philippines have actually heard about you. You started your career in Levi's, and you eventually became the head of the entire North Asia, right? And then you moved on to Starbucks, and you became the Asia Pacific Division head. That's Japan, South Korea, Southeast Asia, Australia, and New Zealand.
That's correct.
Right? Okay. Yes. But let's go back to the very beginning. You have a business degree from Mapua. And you started your career in Levi's. Take us from there.
Okay, well, I joined Levi's in 1974. It was an entry-level job, and I joined the human resource department because I wanted to be a journalist, and they wanted somebody to start a newspaper, a company newsletter, and to edit it as well. And then from there, I was given numerous challenges, which I enjoyed. I mean, they were giving me a new assignment every 18 months. They were sending me all over the world for training and in various disciplines. And by 1991, I became the first minority of any gender to become country general manager.
Amazing.
Yeah. And from there, I went to South America to run the South America business for Levi's. Then was assigned to Japan. I think that was a major milestone.
Right. When you say Japan, you know, in terms of being in the corporate world, it sounds very intimidating. Were you intimidated when you got there?
It was intimidating. And I'll tell you a story. I mean, when I went there and met with incumbent president for Levi's, he gave me 100 reasons why I shouldn't take the job. And when I was being stubborn about it, he said, let me cut to the chase. You're going to fail because you're a Filipino woman.
He said that?
He said that. And he said the only Filipino women they know are those working in their homes or the ones they find in the bars. And it made me so mad.
Yes.
It made me so mad that I took the job. And I wanted so badly to prove him wrong. I didn't. And I did. Because in 18 months' time, we were able to turn around the business. And in 3 years, we actually achieved record profitability. And the brand became the undisputed number one in the market, whereas it was number four when I took over. So he ate his words, and to me that was my biggest revenge.
Right, the sweetest kind,
the sweetest,
I'm sure.
Kind of revenge.
But how in the time that, you know, the first 18 months you were on the job, how were you able to turn it around?
First of all, you know, when you look at a business and it has problems, normally it is about people. It's about demoralized people. It's about people who have been there a long time that they don't see the problems anymore. They're blind to what's happening outside. It's about a lot of inside, you know, thinking. And so that's the first thing you look at and have conversations with everybody, a lot of them. And then you present them with a vision, try to get them along with that vision. And in the process, you'll need to do some cleaning up because there will be people who won't come with you and you can't sacrifice the rest of your organization by keeping them there. So you have to establish credibility in the first year. You have to show them that you know what you're doing and that you are able to lead. So, and I think that's what happened, and I was very fortunate to have really good people. The only marching orders I gave them was break the rules. And it wasn't about breaking the law or doing anything unethical. It was about questioning conventional wisdom and trying to think out of the box. I know that's a cliche, but if we were to beat the competition and get back to our leadership position, we had to think differently. And that's what they did, and I was very fortunate that I had a good team.
Right. What did Levi's do differently during your tenure, would you say?
You know, we were commoditized then. They were selling us at very low prices. And Japan was in a deflationary environment at the time, so it was a race to the bottom in terms of pricing. And, you know, San Francisco was telling me, and all the consultants were telling me, come out with cheaper jeans. I refused. What I did was to step up on innovation, come out with some really nice-looking finishes using the best denims we can find in the world, and then price them at really super premium prices. We had diamond jeans, you know, that we sold for like $1,000. We had jeans that were retailing for $500. The lowest price was like about $120. And sales just went through the roof.
Okay.
And it was restoring the iconic status of the brand. It was really listening to the consumers, but at the same time, giving them more confidence about ownership of a Levi's product.
Right, so it wasn't just about the volume.
It's not about volume, not at all. And I think many people make the mistake.
Right.
Consumers are very discerning, and they're prepared to pay a price for something that's
especially
worth it.
Especially the Japanese, I imagine.
Especially the Japanese consumer.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, how did you make that shift from jeans to coffee? How did you get to Starbucks?
Well, I tried to retire from Levi's, and within a month I got a call from an executive search company.
I like that you tried to retire.
And wanted to know if I would go back to Japan and run the Japan operations of Starbucks, which is the biggest operation outside of the United States at the time. And I said, I don't know anything about coffee. I don't even